The Rankine-Hugonio condition alone is not enough to fully specify our saturation profile. It only gives the shock speed in terms of saturations, but where is the shock? We could have a rarefaction wave followed by a constant state and then a shock to coordinate water, something like this. This yields a number of solutions that are equally valid, but also go a bit further like that. From physical considerations, we know of course that we have only one solution. So which solution is selected and how and on the basis of which physical argument? That's what you will see in this video. Now we know behind the shock the velocity is given by a u-injector over phi times dfw dsw. So that means that the shock velocity has to be greater or equal than this quantity over here. Because suppose the shock velocity would be smaller, then the saturations behind the front would move faster than the shock saturations and would eventually overtake the shock and the solution becomes multivalued. So that's why you know that your shock velocity has to run away, say, from the rarefaction wave. It has to be greater or equal than the velocities in the back. Now, we also know that the physical solution is actually a limit of the following problem. We have again phi dsw dt plus du dx, but then on the right hand side we have some, there's always some diffusion present, denoted by epsilon times the second derivative of sw2x, where epsilon is some positive parameter, so diffusion. And we know that diffusion is small, so our problem is the solution of this problem in the limit where epsilon goes to zero. Now, and from this condition, from the fact that our physical solution is coming actually from another problem where diffusion is included, we can derive that the V-shock is also smaller equal than u-inject over phi times dfw dsw at the shock saturation. Now, this step will be subject of a later video, but let's now for a moment take this step and look at the consequence. Now, if you have both Vs smaller equal than this and Vs bigger equal than this one over here, we know that the shock velocity has to be exactly equal to u inject over phi times dfw dsw at sw. And we know furthermore, due to Hugonio-Rankine, that this shock velocity was also equal to this quantity over here. Now, you can eliminate those factors here, of course, and it yields an equation, dfw dsw at the shock saturation has to be equal to jump in fw divided by jump in sw. fw at the shock minus fw at conate divided by sw at the shock minus sw at conate saturation. Now, due to the specific form of fw, there's usually only one solution of this equation over here if you want to connect to swc, so we have only one shock. It's not possible to construct two sw pluses and sw minuses satisfying this equation over here. So, how is that done? It's done using the so-called Welch tangent construction. Welch was right already long before this formal argument was given. So what do? You plot your fw and then you look for a saturation such that your tangent connects to swc like this. So you need a tangent line, the tangent to your fw function and connect it to swc, because exactly over here, at this point over here, your the slope of your tangent line is exactly equal to the difference delta y in fw's divided by differences in sw's. So using this Welch tangent construction, you can find your shock saturation.